Where you may be, the ground who walks down the aisle. He said, whosoever will, won't you come on to me, for the ground is level at Calvary. For the ground is level at Calvary.
Chapter number 6, and we'll continue our series that we started last Sunday on promise, problem, and provision. And we'll be looking at Deuteronomy chapter number 6, and we'll begin reading about verse number 23. If you've got a Bible, that's good. If not, it'll be on the screen there for you. We even have pew Bibles there for you if you need that. Deuteronomy chapter number 6 and verse 23. Are you there? Say amen.
Amen.
And the Bible says, he brought us out from thence that he might bring us in to give us the land which he sware unto his fathers. And the Lord commanded us to do all these statutes, to fear the Lord our God for our good always, that he might preserve us alive. Let's go to the Lord in a word of prayer. Now, Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, this morning for allowing us to be here again. God, you've been good to us. Lord, we thank you for the ground is level at Calvary. No matter who, what, no whether they may be, the ground is level at Calvary, and we sure do thank you for it. I pray, Lord, you'd help us now the next few minutes get these thoughts and words across that might help the people. And I pray, Lord, you'd do that for us today. In Jesus' name we pray, and all of God's people said, amen. We continue this sermon series, Promise, Problem, and Provision. The first little part of this is going to be a little refresher because maybe you wasn't here last Sunday for whatever reason, and that's fine. How many of you this morning's got a problem? Let me see your hand. Don't look to the right or the left. Don't look to your husband or your wife, all right? And if you want to solve that problem, we're going to look at that this morning. Talk about a problem. There was a young man called 911. He said, hey, my wife has had a heart attack. Can you send an ambulance? And the operator, 911 operator, says, where do you live? He said, Eucalyptus Drive. She said, well, can you spell that? It's long pause there. And he says, how about I drag her over to Oak Street and y'all pick her up over there? Now, I know nobody in here has a problem with disobedience and murmuring and complaining. I know nobody at our church does. I'm talking about people at other churches. Nobody in here I know has a problem with disobedience, murmuring, and complaining. But how many of you know you got relatives that do? Let me see. No one ever gets beyond the reach of problems. No wall that's tall enough, no door strong enough, no man wise enough to escape the problems of life. The only man that has all his problems behind him is a school bus driver. How do you solve your problem? There's a multitude of ways to solve your problem. It reminds me of that priest, the priest and the rabbi. And they had a head-on collision and went off, both of their cars ran off into the ditch, rolled, and it was just a miracle that they were alive. Both of them escaped, and both of them crawled out of their cars, and they crawled over to one another and propped themselves up against one of the cars that had turned over, and they're laying up in the ditch. And the rabbi looked over at the priest and said, hey, we are to celebrate. Everything in my car is destroyed except this big old bottle of Morgan David wine right here. We ought to celebrate our good fortune. I tell you what, I'll split it with you. He pops the top of it, hands it over to the priest. The priest kills about half of it in one go. He hands it back over to the rabbi. The rabbi just puts the top back on it and hands it back to the priest. He said, "You're not going to have any?" He said, "No, the police will be here in just a minute." That's how you solve your problem. Problems spring up suddenly. Problems spring up unexpectedly. Imagine yourself driving down I-40 and you get in a traffic jam and your horn gets stuck. And you look up and right in front of you is the Hell's Angels motorcycle gang. What do you have? You have a problem. It's time for your annual evaluation at work, and you read your employer or your employee's evaluation, and it says, this employee will go far in life, and the sooner he starts, the better. Ladies and gentlemen, problems, whether you know it or not, are an asset. Problems are why you are who you are today. Problems are the reason that you've made improvements in your life. It's an oyster that has a problem that a small, tiny grain of sand penetrates the side of that oyster and causes a problem that brings forth the most beautiful pearl. Helen Keller, born deaf and blind, graduated from college with honors. What'd you say your problem was again? David Ring, born with cerebral palsy. They said, you'll never walk, you'll never be able to talk. You might not ever live to be 10 years old. David Ring is a well-known evangelist, preached a lot in Jerry Falwell's church, travels all over this country with cerebral palsy. He can barely walk, he can talk pretty good, and he preaches a sermon. He says, I have cerebral palsy. What's your problem? How you see the problem is the problem. It takes God one day to get Israel out of Egypt. But it takes him 40 years to get Egypt out of them. It doesn't take God long to save you. He can save you just like that. But sometimes it takes God a lifetime to mold us and to make us into what he wants us to be. Every time when you get saved, you don't turn perfect. You don't know everything about the Bible. And so God is teaching us, and he'll show us problems, and he'll send problems into our life to see how we respond to the problem, to see if we're ready for the provision. Amen. They enter this land. Ladies and gentlemen, you know the story. It's all repetition from last Sunday. We ain't got to the sermon yet. Just hang on. But they're in the land of Egyptian bondage. God says, put the blood on the doorpost. When I see the blood, I'll pass over you. That's a picture of salvation. They get delivered out of bondage. And how many of you know it doesn't take long? As soon as you get saved, guess what's on the other side of salvation? Is a Red Sea problem, problem, problem. How you respond to the problem. You know what some of them said? Some of them said when they got to the Red Sea, Moses, look what you've done to us. We just might as well go on back. We sure ate a whole lot better back there. Murmuring and complaining. And you know what God says? God says, I'm going to part the water, but you fish to go in the wilderness, and you fish to be going in circles. Wandering around the wilderness. They could have made it through that wilderness in 2 weeks. If they'd went straight through in 2 weeks, but it took them 40 years to get to the land flowing with milk and honey. Why? It took them that long, and I hope we get it in 3 Sundays. How you react in the problem determines how long you stay in the problem. The children of Israel took them 40 years in the wilderness. Jesus went into the wilderness of temptation and lasted 40 days. 40 days versus 40 years, how you respond, how Jesus respond. He used the word of God. Children of Israel, how'd they respond? Couldn't find their Bible. Where's my Pentecostal side at? They went from the land of not nearly enough to a land of just enough to a land of more than enough. How you react in the problem determines how long you stay in the problem. The greater the promise, the greater the problem. If God gives you a $1 million promise, he's going to give you a $1 million problem to go along with that to see if you can solve it. Salvation is a promise. Whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. I know whom I have believed and am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I've committed unto him against that day. Those are promises. The assurance of salvation is a promise. 1 John 5 says, these things have I written unto you that you may know that you have eternal life. Those are promises in the Bible. Success in life will be determined by the problems you solve or the problems you create. In this room right now get ready. Don't look at your neighbor. I'm probably talking about somebody that goes to another church. But everybody in here is either causing problems or solving problems. Tommy, you should have stood up on that one. That was good right there. Everybody in here is either creating problems or solving problems. I describe it like this. Everybody in the room has two buckets, including me. You have two buckets, one filled with water, one filled with gasoline. A problem shows up, you either pour water on it, kill it, or pour fire on it and make it go worse. How you respond to the problem determines how long you stay in the problem. There's two important words, ability and willingness. When Goliath roared against Israel and there were 40,000 Israeli soldiers who said, he's too big to whip. Little shepherd boy David says, he's too big to miss. Two looks at the same problem. Two men look out the prison bars. One saw mud, the other saw stars. It's just the direction you're looking in solving the problem. Two men were facing the same problem. Both of their wives have left them. Both of them divorced them. They took their truck, the swimming pool, the house, the cars, and everything else. And one guy jumped off a bridge and drowned himself. The other guy wrote a country and western song about it and got about $350,000 over it. And with $350,000, you can forget about anybody. It all depends on how you respond to the problem. Now, here's a verse I want you to be familiar with. Here's a verse. Let me find it right here. Here's a verse right here. Isaiah 1, 19 and 20. Two verses. Watch this. Isaiah 1, 19. If ye be willing and obedient, ye shall eat the good of the land. All right? That's a promise. But if you refuse and rebel, you shall be devoured with a sword, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken it. Look at that. If you be willing and obedient. Now, let me give you five things. I know what time it is. I can give you five things real quick. Five things to help you solve your problem. Number one, be responsible. Nothing heavy, nothing elaborate, just be responsible. You say, preacher, listen, I'm from the country. The only way I can do this is do it like my mind processes. Responsible. What you got is response able. Able to make an intelligent response. That's what being responsible is. Every problem the nation of Israel faced, they blamed it on Moses. Every problem they faced, they blamed it on God. It was always somebody else's fault. Let me tell you something. Because you and only you are, if the Holy Spirit of God is not controlling your life, then you are in control of your life. You control your thoughts. You control your emotions. You control your words. You control where you go. You control how you dress, what you do, how you act, all that kind of thing. So stop blaming other people for where you are, how you acting, and how you're responding, because you are the reason you are where you're at. Winston Churchill said, the price of greatness is responsibility. I think it's unique in America. We live in an America society now where everything is no fault. We have no fault insurance, no fault divorce. Everything is somebody else's fault besides yours. Woo! where in doubt, it's Trump's fault. You need to look in the mirror every morning and face that person and say, that person right there is the reason I am who I am. I'm like I am and I'm where I am. Take responsibility. You are where you're at today because of the decision you made yesterday. And you'll be tomorrow. The decision you make today will determine where you'll be tomorrow. There's no such thing as indecision. People say, well, I can't make up my mind. Yes, there's no such thing as indecision. Indecision is a decision. You either decide to decide or you decide not to decide, but either way, it's a decision. It's not what happens to you that matters. It's how you respond to what happens to you. You should not be controlled by your emotion. You should not be controlled by your feeling. You should be controlled by the Word of God. If you've got problems, that's wonderful. That means you're a card-carrying member of the human race. Have you got enemies? Have you got problems? Salt your problems with gunpowder. Eat it for breakfast in the morning. Get up and square your shoulders back and drive your enemies up the wall. Eleanor Roosevelt said, nobody can hurt you without your permission. They can't hurt you without you giving them permission to. Boy, I'm telling you, that it's a whole lot better preaching than what I'm getting response for. If you're allowing other people to control you, you're allowing people to control your thoughts, you've crawled yourself into a prison and you've locked the door and handed them the key. Don't let other people control. You are controlled by the Word of God. Amen. Number one, be responsible. Number two, be proactive. That means take action. That means let God take charge of your life or somebody else will. Christianity is an action faith. James says faith without works is dead. Christianity is putting on the whole armor of God and fighting the good fight of faith. Christianity is enduring hardness as a good soldier. Christianity is not some cotton candy religion that you hear in most churches. Amen. Take a stand according to the Word of God and not everybody else's feeling. The Word of God is a two-edged sword. It's a right and a wrong, wheat and the tares, light and darkness, the right way and the wrong way. And if it's not God's way, it is the wrong way. Christianity is Noah building an ark when nobody knew what rain was. Christianity is Jesus going into the temple and turning over the tables upside down. Faith is an action. It's putting your hand to the plow without looking back. It's cutting Goliath's head off with his own sword. It's marching around the walls of Jericho until the walls come tumbling down. It's like Abraham marching up the side of Mount Moriah with his son and saying, God will provide himself a lamb. The just shall live by faith. If you have a problem, attack it, solve it, quit whining about it, get over it. If it happened 25 years ago, get over it. Somebody didn't speak to you last week. Get over it. Amen. Somebody didn't comment on your new shirt that's too little. Get over it. Somebody don't like what you wear. Walk up. Get over it. Get the dust off. Hallelujah. It don't bother you. Shouldn't bother you. Shouldn't bother me. Hey, listen. Watch this. Pay attention right here. God has given us two ends to solve problems. A head and a tail. Heads we think with, a tail we sit on. Heads we win, tails we lose. Amen. That didn't go over too good. Well, be responsible, be proactive. Learn how to react. How you react in the problem determines how long you stay in the problem. It don't matter what the man across the road thinks about you. It matters what the man on the throne thinks about you. Amen. Have faith in God. Faith starts out before you know how it's going to turn out. Faith is the victory that overcomes the world. Quit whining about it. Quit whining about everything that's going wrong. If you woke up this morning and your name is not in the obituary column, Rejoice and thank God for the day he's given you. Amen. Well, hallelujah. Step number four, we're moving fast. I told you. Solving the problem is in self-mastery. Self-mastery. These children of Israel got out of the land of Egypt, took 40 years to get Egypt out of them. In the problem, they discover who they really are. God gave the children of Israel miracle after miracle after miracle. He parted the Red Sea. They was like, woo, ain't that wonderful? He fed them with manna from heaven. Woo, ain't that wonderful? I've heard people say, boy, if I could just see a miracle today. Boy, if I could just see a miracle today. No, you wouldn't. God showed them miracles. They still whined about it. God showed them miracle after miracle. They still complained about it. If God showed you 10 miracles, you'd whine and complain because 11 hadn't showed up yet. Woo, that's good preaching. Hallelujah. Hey, they're walking around in the wilderness. God says, hey, I want to get you off of the promised land. I want to get you off the promised land. I'm going to give you this manna. We don't like the manna. Keep walking in circles. I was going to show you how to get in the promised land, but if you keep murmuring and complaining about, look, if God's cooking for you, don't criticize the cook. I can see Moses' wife, Miriam. She probably wrote a cookbook, 49 Ways to Cook Manna. God, we've had manna soup. We've had manna spaghetti. We've had manna stew. God, we're tired of this. Keep taking another lap. You ain't learned nothing yet. You ever wonder why you keep going in circles and you're moving, but you ain't going nowhere? If you be willing and obedient. Oh, yes. When you're in a problem, forget what you want and ask God what he wants you to have. God sends you in the problem so you can find out who you really are. Who you really are. It's really not difficult. You read the Bible. You obey what he says. Do what he says. I remember a story about a long-haired boy. Long-haired boy went and asked his dad, said, I want a new car. Turned 16, I want a new car. And his daddy didn't like his long hair, and he said, son, look, you get good grades, read your Bible every day, cut your hair, I'll get you a new car. 6 weeks later, brought his report card in, straight A's. He said, daddy, I've read the Bible twice a day. And the daddy looked at him and said, well, you hadn't cut your hair. And he said, well, I've been reading the Bible every day, and Jesus and the disciples didn't have a car. They had long hair. Jesus and the disciples had long hair. His daddy looked at him and said, they walked everywhere they went too. Look, here's a principle. If you want what the Father has, do what the Father says. If you want what the Father has, I try to teach my kids that, Lord have mercy. The Bible. Y'all see this right here? Bible. B-I-B-L-E. Basic instructions before leaving earth. That's what this is. Basic instructions before leaving earth. This is your instruction manual. They keep going around. Same circle. Same circle. God says, hey, I want you to tithe. Well, I ain't going to go that far now, Lord. I don't want to tithe now. Well, stay in debt then. Debt. D-E-B-T. Doing everything but tithing. Man, I'm on a roll this morning. Somebody ought to be saying amen right there. God says, you got a greed problem. I don't have a greed problem. One man says, I'm going to live within my means if I have to borrow money to do it. We go to the mall. We charge $1,000 on a credit card. We go home, tell our husband or wife, said it was just the devil made me do it. And we buy boats that we can't afford and cars, and there's nothing wrong with having all that stuff if you can afford it. Amen. Amen. But we buy stuff we can't afford and we can't pay for. And then we go to our boss and say, boss, I need a raise or I ain't going to make it. And the boss says, if you can't hack it, get your jacket. And now you're without a job. And guess what we do? God, it's your fault. No, dummy, it's your fault. You bought stuff you couldn't pay for. Well, boy, I hit a stump right here. I better go on to the next point. Take another lap. Number five. And here's the most important. Give absolute obedience to the Word of God. Amen. Decide today. God, I'm not going to live my life according to what Fox News says, what all the news media says. I'm going to live my life by this. Amen. I'm not going to live in faith. I'm not going to live in fear. I'm going to live in faith. Amen. I'm not going to live by feelings. I'm going to live by faith. Amen. I'm going to do what this says, no matter what everybody else thinks. Well, what do you think about it? What do you think about this? Who cares? What does God say about it? And whatever God says about it, that's what I'm going to do. And that's what I'm going to follow. You say, well, you'll be in the minority. I'll just be going to heaven on my minority. Standing on the promises of God. Willing and obedient. Walking by faith. David says, thy word is a lamp unto my feet, a light unto my path. Stop living in the past. Stand on the promises of God. Stop playing the blame game. Everybody else's fault. It was mom and dad's fault. It's the way I was raised. I didn't have a dad. And it's preacher's fault. And he didn't come to see me when I stubbed my toe on the bedpost. And he didn't call. And it's everybody's fault. It's the church's fault. It's everybody's fault. No, it's your fault. I thought this sermon would go over better, but it ain't. Solving your problem. Let me end by saying this. God gave Job everything. Job, 42 chapter. Ain't got time to read it this morning. Gave Job everything. The promises of God. But guess what? Along with all of that comes the problem. And the problem, God took away Job's family, took away his kids, took away his house, took away everything he had. Job sitting in a pile of ashes, looking up with nothing. God give him everything. He looks up to a God in heaven. He says, the Lord has given and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Amen. And in that, Job sinned not. Amen. Let me say this in closing. Sammy's getting ready, and I think Jeff will maybe singing something. Y'all get ready for that. But they tell me, when you get ready to purify gold, silver, whatever, Tommy, what they would do, they'd put that, all that silver and gold in a big old pot, and they'd heat it up. Heat it up in the furnace. They start heating that thing up. And what that does, all the impurities rise to the top. Just a little ugly gunk stuff. You ever wondered why some of your gold, some is 18 carat, some is whatever? That's based upon how much gunk they get off of the bottom of that thing. They heat that thing up, and that stuff rises to the top, how pure gold is. So that stuff rises to the top, and they got this little thing. When that stuff rises to the top, like foams up at the top, and they take something, and they, off of the top of that big old tub thing, and they scrape off what boils up to the top. Turn the heat up more. Here comes some more stuff. And it becomes pure. The more those impurities are pushed off to the side. You say, preacher, I'm going through the fire. You ever wondered? God didn't deliver the three Hebrew boys out of the fire. He just got in there with them. He didn't deliver them out of the fire. He got in there with them. Sometimes problems will make that stuff come to the top. The stuff that God's trying to get out of us. That he don't want in us. And did you know at the end of Job's life, God says, or Job says, Lord giveth, Lord take away, blessed be the name of the Lord. And by the end, you get to the end of Job, God gave Job more than what he lost. He got into the provision, but he couldn't get into provision without going through the problem. And the quicker we learn that. You say, preacher, have you learned? I hadn't learned it yet. I'm still struggling with that. I still look up at God and say, God, you're trying to kill me. And these sermons come back and play in my mind. Practice what you preach. You know. It's tough. As a Christian, sometimes problems, and that's the way our mom and dads did to us. growing up as a kid. We pose them and give them obstacles to teach them and to train them to become what we'd like to see them become. God does the same way. He gives you a promise. He'll give you a problem to go along with it and see how you respond. Don't murmur and complain. That's tough, because I do it. Look up to God and say, God, you've given, you've taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord anyway. And just see what God does for you. Heavenly Father, I thank you, Lord. I hope that's meant something to somebody. I hope it's helped somebody in some way. And Lord, somebody needs to come. Just give, lay it all on the altar. Let people know that God, you truly do love us. And you want the best for us. In Jesus' name. Let's stand all the building.
Why did he go to Calvary? Why was his life's blood shed for me? And why did he suffer as no man has ever done? There's just one reason. And I am the one. He loves me. He loves me. Jesus loves me. He loves me, yes, he loves me, Jesus loves me. When I am sad, you know, he loves me. And even, Lord, when I am so bad, oh, you still love me. And when it seems that no one ever cares, cause I know you will always love me. Oh, he loves me. Yes, Lord, you love me. Jesus, oh, he loves me. Oh, yes, he loves me.
Good to be in the house of the Lord today.